I am, Mr. Giroux.
Okay, we are going to start setting up or discussing in statistics the binomial setting. So let's get started. If you read a question and each trial only has two outcomes, such as pass-fail, heads, tails, boy, girl, success, failure, you know, two outcomes, you could have a binomial setting. Now there's another type of variable in statistics that also will have the idea of having two possible outcomes, and it's not binomial. So don't just think, oh, I read this question and someone's shooting free throws and they either make it or they miss it, or I'm taking a test and it's either right or wrong. Just because of that does not mean you're automatically in a binomial setting. No, you have four checks. Each observation is either a success or failure, just said that. There is a fixed N observations. I'm going to take a test that has 20 questions. I'm going to ask 500 people a particular question and there's only two responses. I'm going to have children and I'm going to have, you know, I am going to have four kids. Not sure you can plan that out, but some people say, you know, that's how many kids I want. All observations are independent and the probability of success is constant. So if we're talking about maybe taking a multiple choice test, if some questions give you four possible answers, some give you five, maybe some of the questions are true-false, then that would not be a binomial setting, because if there's four possible answers, you have a 25% chance of being correct, at least if you're guessing. And if it's true-false, it's 50-50. Or think of it as you're at batting practice where you either hit the ball or not. Well, if you're getting coached in between each trial, then hopefully if that coaching is well and you're learning, your chances of success is going to rise. So any of those type of ideas or settings where the probability of success is not constant, that will not be a binomial setting. When determining if there's a binomial setting, the independence check can be a little bit tricky. Remember we talked about doing quality control at the end of an assembly line. You know, they only make a certain number of, well, whatever it is you're doing quality control on. Could be millions of items, it could be just a couple thousand. Well, if you find a faulty item, then you're lowering, you know, theoretically you're lowering the probability of finding your next faulty item, if only a certain percentage of them actually are faulty. Well, as long as your population is greater than 10 times the sample size, you can assume there is independence as long as it is a random selection. So this idea of your population being over 10 times the sample size, that statement gets used a lot and pretty much should be at somewhere in every statistical test that you run, because not only is it a good statement for proving independence, but it also is a required statement for every single one of the standard deviation formulas we're going to learn this year. Every standard deviation formula is only good, only gives valid results if you are pulling from a population that is over 10 times the size of your sample. All right, bang it. Next.
Page of notes.
Boogie dokie. Bam! All right. Binomial distribution. If you have a binomial setting, then your variable could, well, will have a distribution. Now, like if I say 35% of the population does something and you go out and sample them, you should get results that are around 35%. It doesn't have to be bell-shaped, I don't know why I'm doing that, it could be skewed, but the results should be around the same as the population as long as it's not biased. Remember, law of large numbers, as long as your sample or your experiment increases in size, the mean of your population, or the mean of your sample should approach the mean of the population as long as it is unbiased, law of large numbers. Binomial distribution. You need to have X defined as the number of successes, and a later chapter is going to be defined as the percent of successes. So that would not be a binomial distribution, but it will be a binomial variable. So at this point, we're going to define X as the number of successes. N is going to be the number of trials. So I'm going to flip a coin 20 times and record the percent of heads. I'm going to ask 500 people a question and record their responses of yes or no. And the P, the probability, is recorded as probability of success. So with these definitions and statements, X can take on a whole number value between 0 and whatever N is, with a distribution of B, parentheses, N, comma, P. We've had notation, shorthand notation like this as well. You might remember one that was N and then mu sigma, where it was shorthand for this notation should be telling you that, okay, I'm looking at a normal distribution with a certain mean and a certain standard deviation. So you have that similar kind of notation for binomial settings. How many ways can you have k successes? Oh, by the way, this binomial distribution is not always going to be normal. We'll be discussing when we do something called normal approximation, we'll be discussing how we check if our binomial distribution is normal. Okay, at any rate, how many ways can you have k successes in n observations? I'm going to give you a couple of formulas that relate to the binomial setting. Well, there's the binomial coefficient, and that is n over k. Now, that's not a fraction. There's no fraction bar in here, just a set of parentheses and two stacked numbers. The top number is the number of trials you're going to run, and the bottom number is the number of successes that you're concerned with. And the formula is n factorial, or as I like to say, n over k factorial times n minus k. I just yelled and, you know, brighten the class up, and besides, you know, who wants to keep saying factorial all the time? So n is n factorial. And if you don't know what the explanation mark means, 5 factorial, or 5, is 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. The factorial notation is repeated multiplication, and you count down by 1 until you get to the value of 1. And how does that work? Well, here's an example. How many ways can you have 3 successes out of 100 trials? Well, 10 trials, 3 successes. How many ways can that happen? In other words, if you take 10 free throws, how many ways can you only make 3 of them? It could be the first 3, the last 3, the first 2, and the last 1. Well, I can't name all the values or all the combinations because we'll see it's 120. So 10 over 3, 10 trials, 3 successes. That's going to be 10 over 3 times 10 minus 3. And 10 factorial is 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. 3 factorial is 3, 2, 1. And 7 factorial is 7, da 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 da. Now, with factorials, if you work them out by hand, a lot of cancellation will, of course, occur. And sometimes you might need to write these out by hand because your calculator might not have enough memory to deal with these values if they're too large. And no need to write them out like this all the way down to 1 if you start to see where the cancellation is going to happen. Here we can though, so 7 through 1 cancel out. 9 divided by 3 is 3. 8 divided by 2 is 4. And 10 times 3 times 4 is 120 ways. So if you do something 10 times and it's only a setting where there's only two possible outcomes, pass, fail, make the shot, not make the shot, there's 120 ways to have only 3 successes out of 10 trials. You certainly would not want to write all of those combinations out. So, that's how you find the number of successes out of a certain number of trials in a binomial distribution. Bam! Moving on. Okay, this is going to be a two-part video. I have two chalkboard fulls of notes, full of notes to give you for this binomial distribution idea. And this is the end of our first part. What is the probability of observing k successes out of n observations? In other words, it's not just how many ways can you find or see a certain number of successes out of a certain number of trials, but finding the actual probability of that. So, here's the formula. The probability, the binomial probability, this formula will be given to you on the AP exam if you happen to be taking that. The probability that you observe, x is the number of successes, you observe a certain number of successes, is n over k, the binomial coefficient, times the probability of success, times the, or raised to the number of successes you're expecting, times 1 minus the probability of success, or the probability of failure, raised to the n minus k power, or how many of those failures are you going to have? So, same similar idea, so I don't have to rework the numbers all from scratch. We have 3 successes out of 10, but now I want to find the probability of getting 3 successes out of 10, given that the probability of success is 45%. Well, the probability that x equals exactly 3, that you get exactly 3 successes out of your 10 trials with the binomial probability formula is 10 over 3. This is the number of ways you can get 3 successes out of 10. We just worked that out. It was 120. Times the probability of success raised to the power or the number of successes we expect to find, or we'd like to find, times 1 minus the probability of success raised to the 10 minus 3 or n minus k power. That'll be the number of times you don't see that success. And it comes out to be 16.6% when you get all this worked out. Well, the binomial probability formula is on your formula sheet. It is important if you understand what it is used for and how to use it. But in regular practice, we're not going to use that formula very often. We're going to be using our calculator. So the binomial PDF command, that should be under the distribution menu of your calculator, will be, and we'll do a calculator lab, a video lab for that in the next few days. Binompdf, binomial distribution, you're looking for one specific outcome, the number of trials, the probability of success, and the number of successes we're looking for. So the probability that you find exactly, or you have exactly 3 successes out of 10, is binompdf, 10 trials, 45% chance of success, observing 3 successes out of those 10 trials, and again, we got the 16.6%. Now, I didn't highlight that the binomial distribution is a type of discrete random variable. I wrote it but didn't read it off. So let's answer some other questions beyond the initial example and let me show you how to use your calculator in the binom PDF and the binom CDF command. That's really more common use or common command that you do in your homework to find questions like this. Again, 10 trials. What's the probability we have 3 or fewer trials? So what's the probability of 0 trials, probability of getting 1 success, 2 successes, and 3 successes? Well, that's a lot of possibilities, and I don't want to write or type in binom PDF over and over and over again. So we're going to do binom CDF. If I say C stands for cumulative, it's going to add up multiple PDF probabilities. And so the probability that x is less than or equal to 3 is binom CDF, 10, 0.45, the probability of success again and again with the 3, but my probability is now 0.266. And that's a probability of being 3 successes, 2 successes, 1 successes, and then finally none out of our 10 trials. Now your calculator with the binom CDF command is for binomial settings. It is for when the variable is defined as a count or a number of successes, and T83s and T84s only count down. So if you want to find the probability of observing more than 3 successes, the opposite of more than 3, that's 4 up to 10 successes, the opposite of more than 3 successes is 3 or fewer successes. The complement idea. So this is going to be 1 minus binom CDF, 10, 45, 3 again. And you'll see that these add up to 1 because greater than 3 is the complement to less than or equal to 3. And if I take away the equal sign, if I add in the equal sign and say 3 or more, because this is a discrete random variable, the probability that x equals exactly 3 will have an actual probability, not like a continuous variable where it's equal to 0. And that's going to be 1 minus binom CDF, and you'll see I've changed the 3 to a 2 because the opposite of 3 or more, 3 successes or 4 or 5 up to 10, the opposite of 3 or more is 2 or less. So there's the last binom CDF command. I'm nearly out of time. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go to your homework. And do me a favor and watch part 2.